And we did that, yes. It was a busy case. Wife and
household.
It didn't work out good for us. It is. I've been here before.
Thank you.
I did the same thing, even though I got two stories.
And it's good for, they say, to put a sheet of paper where your intake is, to put a sheet of air, and it'll...
Good morning to all, and welcome to each and every one that are here. We welcome you this morning on the last Sunday in January, January 30th. So we do welcome everyone. It's good to see all who are here with us this morning. Let's all stand as Al comes and leads us in our call to worship. Hymn number 445, Sweet Hour of Prayer, our opening prayer.
Us realize the closeness that becomes in prayer with you. That Father, it's just you and me, or you and us. Father, that I just thank you that we're able to, and I pray that we'll continue to be able to worship you, Father, to come before you in song and in prayer and in praise. Father, I pray for those that aren't with us this morning. We know that we do have some sick, and we know that we do have some that are away. Pray that you'll bless them and be there with them, wherever they are, whatever they're doing. Take charge of your service. Lead us, guide us, and direct us. In our Son's precious name we pray. Amen.
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 Amen. You see it? Just a few announcements coming up in the month of February, of course, as we are now heading out of January after Monday. February the 14th, of course, is Valentine's Day. And then the 21st of February, again, is President's Day. And again, remind you that it is basically a federal holiday even here. So all your federal places, and I think even your post office, and there may be even some banks that you deal with may be off as well on President's Day. So be aware of that on the 21st. I don't want you to be taken by surprise. Then at the end of February, February 28th through March the 4th, here in St. Tammany Parish, there is no school for the Mardi Gras holiday for that week. So be aware of that. And of course, Mardi Gras is the first Tuesday in March. So be aware of that, of what's going on. Until further notice, I'm thinking just probably a few weeks, no Sunday school or Wednesday night Bible study, until the COVID starts to decline a little bit. You know, people are getting affected. I guess the only good thing about this phase of people getting the COVID is that it's on a lot of people, it's not really that devastating. It's more like they're getting a cold or they're getting sinus infection and that's about it. But there are people that are affected by it that are still being hospitalized because maybe they have some health issues already and it's affecting them. So be aware of that as we're going through another phase of this. So just be aware of that. So again, we're going to, until further notice, I'm thinking just a few more weeks and then we'll get back to having our Sunday school and Wednesday night Bible study for anybody who would like to come for that. You can find us on Facebook and also on YouTube as well. Any other announcements we need to be aware of anything else going on or taking place? Clarence, is there any updates on any kind of testing or anything that with anything going on with any of this COVID?
No, not right now in the parish. I mean, for us testing, we stopped testing last week.
Okay.
We did bring vaccinations back to Pritchard Park just this past Friday.
Okay.
So we'll look at it this week. It all depends on what kind of turnout we had last Friday.
Okay.
We'll determine on if we continue to vaccinate.
Okay.
Because we just, when we push out those resources to have at least 12 or 15 employees out doing vaccination, we only have 5 or 6 people show up. Just
okay.
Can't continue to waste those resources like that. So we'll see where we are as a result of that.
Sure. Okay. Appreciate that. If you do need a mask, if you'd like to take some home, we have some in the back. Feel free to take a few of them with you, just to have them. You know, where you can put them either in your purse or you can put them in your car or whatever, and that way you can have them, and that way you'll feel comfortable when you're going in and out of places as well. So feel free to do that. So they're back on the foyer table back there. You can have a few of them if you care to have any, and that will help with that as well. Mr. Al will come at this time and he'll lead us in another hymn as we sing hymn number 181, No, Not One.
No, not one. No, not one.
Lord Jesus, he knows about our struggles, day in and day out, each individual. He knows what we're going through, he knows what's taking place in our lives, and he's there with us. And remember what the Word of God says. Even though sometimes you may think it's not, but he won't give us any more than we can bear. That's his promise. And if you are thinking, well, man, I'm sure bearing a lot or I'm doing a lot, he knows what you can bear and what you can do. He knows just how much your shoulders can handle, regardless of your age or your health or whatever the case may be. And it's everything for a reason and a purpose. And so we continue to look to him. So understand, he understands what we're going through, and he understands what we're dealing with day in and day out as well. In the way of prayer, in the back of our bulletins, we want to make mention of many, many things that's going on. Sandy Deal and family, I'd ask you to pray for them. Bobby and the children and the others, they were sick this past week, but none of them had COVID. They went and got tested, and evidently, you know, they probably sick, probably with a cold or sinus infection, who knows. So Sandy Deal said, well, I'm going to stay and watch it online just in case, you know, it isn't, or, you know, even though they tested negative. So I want us to pray for Sandy Deal and the family, Bobby, Delilah, Elena, and the rest of them as well, who are there, and pray for them and remember them in prayer. Also, Brian and Mandy are not here because Logan now is under the weather. Logan, I think, locked himself in his room hoping that he wouldn't get anything, and he winds up getting something. So Logan's not a happy camper right now. But pray for them as they are dealing with that, because both, because Brian and them did have it last week, and then they got tested again, they were negative, and now Logan is under the weather. So just pray for them and remember them in prayer. Brenda Gladys, we continue to pray for Brenda Gladys. She did some work and some things and all, and unfortunately she picked up something a little bit too heavy, twisted her back, and now she hurt her back. So pray for Brenda Gladys as she now has her back is out of whack a little bit and hurting her. So pray for Brenda Gladys and pray on what she's dealing with. Johnny and Debbie Garrett, continue to pray for them. They're still in Kentucky. He sent me some pictures this week of them. And for those of you who like it, maybe next time you can go with them. They're getting a whole bunch of snow.
They don't watch a 4 degree weather, too.
Well, hey, they get a lot of cold weather, but they get a bunch of snow. So he sent me pictures of the snow out there, and I informed him. I said, well, I'm glad. I said, I'm sorry you're going through there, but anyhow, he's dealing with the snow, and they're dealing with the snow. So I guess that's why I'm here. I'm not up there. And Clara says the same thing. That's why I'm here, not up there. He says he may have to get a snow shovel to bring back with him next time, so I don't know. But anyway, pray for them. Remember them in prayer, both of them. Family issues, you know, so they, Mom and Beverly and other family members there, they have health issues. So pray for them and remember them in prayer. But also continue to remember Johnny and Debbie, of course, and especially Johnny with his ongoing battle with cancer, his treatments, and also his hurting and what he deals with the pain that he's going through. You know, he really doesn't tell people too much of anything concerning it, but you need to understand he does have some pain that he's going through, and we need to continue to pray for him as he goes through that, and continue to remember him in prayer. Janet is not here with us this morning. She's having some stomach issues. Nothing to do with COVID or anything. It's just she probably ate some stuff maybe last week or so, and it's made her stomach go upside down, upside down, whatever, however it does it with her. So inside out, whatever, yeah. So pray for Janet as she is dealing with stomach issues and the pain that she's also, and she's on medication now. But just pray for her and remember her also in prayer. Continue, of course, to pray for all who are in nursing homes and in hospitals. and the many, many people that are still dealing or that are dealing with COVID and COVID-related issues as well. So do pray for them as well. Traveling mercies for those who are traveling and will be traveling. Pray for them and remember them also in prayer. Other prayer requests, concerns, Thanksgiving, or whatever you would like to share with us this morning. Anyone or anything. Debbie.
Prayer of Thanksgiving. All of Sarah's biopsies came back negative, so they're pretty sure she's cancer-free.
Awesome. Whoa. That is awesome. Yes. Yeah, and Sarah is doing wonderfully well. She's chomping at the bits to get back home. And also to drive a big truck. So she's doing good and so continue to pray for her with that, but prayer of Thanksgiving that she too is doing good and in the healing process and everything else. So awesome. Praise God. Tinka.
I have two prayer requests.
Sure.
I've been fighting a sinus infection for a couple of weeks now.
Right.
And it's aggravated my COPD for the first time in 2 years.
Okay.
But it's left me very weak and cold.
Hard to breathe. Yes.
So pray that
will clear up.
Way out.
That's right. Yes.
Also, and more importantly, my son is scheduled to get his lithotripsy this Wednesday.
Okay. Wow.
It's been postponed a couple of times, and he's like, he can't take it anymore. Please pray that
he can go through it that way. That's right.
Get the lithotripsy, and then he can get the hernia operation.
That's right. Yeah. So. Yeah. My heart goes out to him with the kidney stones. Yes. Those are nobody's head. It's very painful. So we'll pray for Sean with that, and then we'll have other things done as well. Sure will. Linda.
Remember Vicky?
Yes.
With her knee, she's doing better.
Okay.
She tried to work a few hours the other day, and it's kind of swollen. So remember her. And then I can tell you, her daughter just had a baby, and now her daughter has preeclampsia, or whatever it's called. And the baby had a good checkup, and then the next day they called her and told her to get the baby to Children's Hospital because she's having cardiac problems.
Really?
And then.
And how old is the baby?
2 weeks.
Two weeks. Really?
Yeah,
2 weeks. Wow.
She's about 2 weeks old.
Yeah. Okay. Whatever. She has BNP or something. Your levels are supposed to be 100. Hers was 1,000.
Wow.
So and she was having. She had a hole in her heart. She had a murmur, which those weren't the problem. So I don't know. Just pray that.
Pray for the mother and pray for the daughter. Yes. Okay.
And then also just stress on her husband and she has two other children, little boys, and then and then Mickey and everybody, because it's just a lot for them to have to deal with.
Right. Okay. We'll pray for them. Appreciate it. Thank you. Yes. Other prayer requests. Thanksgiving concern. Clarence.
Just unspoken prayers and prayer of thanks. Thanks for God's grace and His mercies.
Absolutely. Thank you. Okay. Good. Others? Ginger.
Prayer of Thanksgiving to be here this morning.
Yep.
For the first time, it seems like a year. And also continue prayer for my family, and especially for Lois. You've been a little bit lightheaded lately and took a fall today.
Oh, yeah.
So, legs have given out on us. So.
Yeah, I asked if she heard anything. She said no. She said, I just thought, well, if you didn't hear anything, that's good. That's good. So, yeah, we'll pray for you and Dolores and, of course, Al as well. Remember all of y'all in prayer. We sure will. Other prayer requests?
Yeah.
Yes, Audie.
My brother-in-law has pneumonia, so I'd like to pray for that.
Oh, wow. Okay. All right. We'll do. Yes. What's his name?
Mike.
Okay.
Yeah, Mike, what's your death?
Okay. Well, we will do that, yes. Mr. Billy Lynch, how's the family?
I haven't heard anything, so I don't think
I'm doing good. I need to pray for Kim back there as well. He got some dental work done, and he's still having a little problem or some pain every now and then. So remember you in prayer with your dental work that you had done, and remember him in prayer as well with what he's dealing with. Yes, sir.
I thought it was only going to have four removed.
Right.
But they had seven.
Wow.
And I've had a problem with bleeding.
Right.
But they also, he found out that I got too much bone or something on the back of each side.
Uh-huh.
And they had to go in and grind the bone down to fit my dentures in. But I'm making it.
Well, good. Yeah,
appreciate all the prayers.
Absolutely. So we'll keep you in prayer with all of that. So, yes, sir. Appreciate that. Be in prayer, of course, for Shell Armstrong. She had some work done on her eye this past week over at Lakeside Hospital in Metairie. We took her there on Wednesday, and they had a bunch of work done. It was the right eye or left eye? Right eye, yes. And they did a whole bunch of work there, and he said it's looking good. So just pray for Shell and her progression and also her healing with that. She goes back to the doctor Wednesday, Thursday, right? Yeah, Thursday here in 2020, and they're going to take a look at it. So, but just pray for her and what she's dealing with both her eyes. Both her eyes have issues. So just continue to pray for her and pray that by God's grace and power that she will be able to see through her eyes, because right now she can't see very much at all. And matter of fact, she's not even able to see enough to even drive. So just pray for her that maybe by God's grace and mercy that she'll be able to do that one day as well. So just pray for her and what she is dealing with her eyes. Others on our prayer list, just continue to remember them in prayer as well. Again, Debbie's mom, who has health issues. Beverly, who has health issues. Charles and Linda Davis, continue to remember them in prayer. Linda and Mike Hemel, remember them in prayer as well. And so many others on our prayer list, not to omit any, but just pray for the different ones that we continue to pray for, as well as others as well. Pray for each other during the course of the week. As always, two things. One, pray for salvation for those who do not know Jesus Christ. Even if they don't want you to pray for them, they can't stop you from praying. Pray for them. Pray for a family member, a co-worker, a friend, or even a complete stranger. And as always, give thanks to the Lord for answered prayer. Even if it's the answer you didn't want, there's a reason for it. Always a reason. You know, and you may not see it today or tomorrow, but down the line you'll say, okay, now I know why the Lord told me that wasn't the way for me to go, or that wasn't for me to do, or wasn't the place for me to go, or whatever the case may be. We never know. But now, if you're bringing up something to the Lord and you're asking for His will, then understand, His will may not be your will, but it may be the fact that this is what He wants for you in your life. So, always give thanks to the Lord for answered prayer. Yes, no, wait, whatever the case may be. You know, we need to walk by faith and not by sight. You see, our problem is we want to walk by sight and say, oh, yeah, I need this, or this is, you know, the Lord says, no, this is not it. So pray, give thanks to the Lord for all things and everything. And again, pray for each other. Pray for each other, and especially pray for your enemies, for those that don't like you or those you're having difficulties with. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, as we come now, Lord, we lift up all the prayers, all the concerns, and many, many things that are going on in all of our lives. Lord, there are many, many people dealing with different health issues and health problems. They've all been voiced up to you, and even some unspoken prayers. We lift them all up before you, and we pray for your grace, for your mercy. We pray for healing power. We pray for help. We pray, Lord, for salvation for those who do not know Jesus Christ, whomever they may be. We pray for traveling mercies for those who are traveling and will be traveling. We pray, Lord, that you'll be with us day in and day out and help us as we journey. Be with us at work, at home, and wherever else we go. We thank you, Lord, for the many times you have been with us and you have lifted us up, and there you were helping us and being with us as well. We thank you for your many, many blessings and all that you have done. We pray for the many, many people that are dealing with COVID and also COVID-related issues, to be with them as well. For those who are dealing with back problems or other health issues, we lift them up, like Brenda Gladys. We pray for Sean as he will be dealing with lipotripsy, as well as hernia later on. We lift him up. Shell Armstrong with her eyes, we pray for him, for her. For Johnny Garrett with his ongoing battle with his cancer. And again, Janet with her stomach ailments, and then of course, Michael with pneumonia. Audie's brother-in-law, we lift him up. And again, so many people are dealing with so many different health issues and health problems. We just give them up to you and just ask for your help, grace, mercy, and healing power. Be with us now. Lead us, guide us, and direct us. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Let us stand at this time as Al comes now and he'll lead us in our offertory hymn. Hymn number 63, Abide With Me. If you have your Bibles this morning, turn, if you will, to a very, very, very familiar passage. John chapter 3 and verse 16. February the 14th is Valentine's Day, a couple of weeks away. Now, Valentine's Day, of course, as we know it, is set aside to celebrate love and friendship. And they do it by exchanging cards, flowers, candy, and etc. to each other, as far as with different people. But did you know that Valentine's Day originated as a Christian feast, and originated in honoring one or two Christian martyrs back in the 3rd century? And one of the martyrs and one of the people comes about is, the person was Saint Valentine. He was a Catholic priest. So why is it honored after him, and why is it that it comes? Well, because, and what it has to do with love. Well, this Catholic priest, what happened is, and you can go back and read it at another time and look it up, but what happened is Valentine, he defied the emperor Claudius at the time, and he secretly married a man and a woman together in order to keep the husband, spare the husband from going to war. See, back then Claudius figured that an unmarried man was more prone to be better in battle than a married person. And so he made a decree that people were not to get married anymore, the young men. Because what he wanted was, he wanted the young men to be in battle all the time. And so Claudius defied his decree, and he married people, and of course he was found out, put in prison, and unfortunately he was tortured in 3 ways, and you can go back and you can read it of it, but eventually he was killed by the emperor because of his defiance against his decree, where I'm sure he made a point of it, I must obey God and not man in this case. So this is why we have the Valentines after him and many others as well. But today, what I want us to look at is at this familiar passage of John 3:16, and know that love in the present sense, and the real Valentine thing, could come from Jehovah God through his son Jesus the Christ. And so I want us to read this and to expound upon a little bit of it, of what Jesus told Nicodemus about God's love, which is agape love. So this is the first thing we see. Notice, as you're familiar with it in John 3:16, it says, "For God so loved the world." Now, what are we talking about here when it says that God so loved the world?
The people.
That's right. The people, everyone. And this love that we're talking about when he says God so loved the world is not a brotherly type of love. It is not a romantic type of love. It is called agape love. Agape love is unconditional love. He loves you regardless of what you do or don't do. Now, he's not happy with some of the things that we do that we're not supposed to do, but he still loves. Contrary to what people say, and even contrary to maybe what you were taught when you were coming up as a child, because I know it was told to me, if you continue to do that, God's not going to love you anymore. Now, I've been told that many times growing up. Put the fear of God in you, right? But that's not the case. God still loves. He's not happy, but he still loves. And this is the very nature of Jehovah God. To love a people that is vile, evil, and full of sin. Now, think back to the beginning. Think back to when Noah's day, when the Lord looked down and he saw everything under inclination, and thought everything was evil. And what he told Noah to do was build his ark. And many people think that God didn't love. But contrary to what many people think about that, is that he did love. For you see, he gave those people 120 years to turn from their evil ways. Noah, it took Noah 120 years to build the ark. And during that time, Noah preached to the people. He told them what God expected and what God wanted. He probably even told them, look, God loves you, and he wants the best for you. What you need to do is to turn away from sin and turn to God. And I wasn't there, and we don't have much on that, but probably they laughed at him. They thought he was out of his mind and everything else. And they rejected Noah's idea concerning God's love. And they rejected God's love as well. See, God loves, it's the people. And understand, as it says, for God so loved the world, we're not just talking about one race, but everyone. Everyone. All people, regardless of their race, their color, even their religion. You've got a lot of isms around here. A lot of isms. And you know what? God even loves them. God cares about what they are doing and what's taking place in their life. All of that. See, regardless of the person's, even the person's position, where they may be at, CEO, person just working out in the field, a person working outside, inside, you know, whatever they may be doing. Now, many people you may hear of, they speak of God as a stern, angry, unforgiving God who sits on his throne and all he wants is he's got this lightning bolt in his hand. And what he's going to do, he's going to strike you every time you do something wrong. You see, they got in their mind some of these Greek gods, like Zeus and the rest of them, those are all fables. God is not sitting on his throne and with a bolt of lightning ready to strike those people that do wrong. He is not there and causing destruction, as so many people like to think. That idea is so wrong. There's no foundation for that. This is people who thought of these things. I don't know where they even get it from. Because you're not going to find that in the Word of God. It doesn't say that God is sitting on his throne with a bolt of lightning and ready to strike down the people. If he did, none of us would be here today. We'd all be struck down. Every one of us. And you read throughout the Bible. Throughout the whole Bible. And especially, I like the Old Testament. Many people don't. You look at the Old Testament. Look at how God was so full of love, compassionate, grace, and mercy. There's so many people in the Old Testament. Again, you read about so many things. Even Abraham, the things that he done, God was gracious unto him. Lot, as Lot went to a city that he wasn't supposed to go to, and yet God took him out of that and was full of grace and mercy. So many others, Israel, Jacob, David, Paul, Peter, and the names are just, you can go on and on if you look not only in the Old Testament, the New Testament, and see all of this, and I think expressed really, really well, it's from God's Word, is in Psalm 103, and in verse 8 through 10. Here it says, the Lord is compassionate and gracious. He is slow to anger, and watch this, abounding in love. That abounding in love is agape love, again. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repays us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. That's amazing, isn't it? Now, as I read this and I thought about it, and I'm saying, wow. He does not harbor his anger forever. It seems man has harbored his anger forever against someone else. You see that happening. Also, it seems as though man or woman, they will repay people for their iniquities, for things that they were done. And they don't repay them just once or twice. They keep on repaying people for things they've done to them or about them or whatever. It seems as though rather than forgive and forget, oh, they forgive, but they don't never forget. And they try to do their own vengeance. Where the Lord says, vengeance is mine, says the Lord, I will repay. Now, I guess they put their place in a they put themselves in the place of God, I guess. I guess that's how it happened. And they harbor this anger. And it makes it life terrible, not only for themselves, but also for other people as well, by harboring ill-gotten anger and not allowing. But the Lord is full of compassion and gracious and abounding in love. Now, who wrote this? David. Now, who would know better about God's gracious compassion and how he's slow to anger and abounding in love than someone who committed adultery and committed murder? And God came to him and said, this is what you have done. And what did he do? He repented when God brought it before him. He didn't make excuses and say, well, you know, look, this person made me do it, or that person, or this. He took matters into his hand about his own sin. He repented of it. Sure, he suffered the consequences. And I believe he suffered the consequences more than one-fold or two-fold in his lifetime. Because not only was the baby killed, but also some of his sons, and even his kingdom was taken away finally at the end of it, as far as with everything, because of all that he done. However, God was still abounding. God still loved David. And God even said, he is a man after my own heart. And the reason he was a man after God's own heart is because when God brought his sin before him, he repented of it. And he knew. And so that love here. And so we see. Now, again, all of this is coming out of this, and he did not hesitate to do this. What we have to understand is this. When God says, when it says in here, for God so loved the world, we think of the whole world, and that's true. But God loves each one of us as if we are only one of us. In other words, he loves us as individuals. Not just the whole world, but individuals. As a person, he loves us. And he cares for us. So you can even put that in there, for God so loved me. He loved me. And how much did he love me? That brings us to the second thing we see here. And we show the magnitude or the amount of love that God truly loved. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. God's Son is Jesus Christ. God didn't have many sons, only one. Contrary to what another religion teaches, Satan was not God's son. Jesus was the Son of God, but he was also God. Something hard for us to put into our brain. This magnifies his love in giving his only begotten Son to do what? To a sinful, dying, evil world. He gave. How many of you, I don't have a son, but you have a son. How many of you would put your son and have him sacrificed for someone else? And for someone else that really don't care one way or the other. But yet God did this. He sent this son. And he even says so in Romans chapter 5 and in verse 8. It says in here, it says, very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare die. But I doubt that very seriously as well. But it says, but God demonstrated his own love for me, in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Not when we were good enough, or not when we came to him. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And this is why God, as Jesus is telling Nicodemus, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to die for sinners. To be what? The Redeemer that was needed for them. He gave up his Son to suffer and die for the world, for a world of sinful people. that truly did not have a relationship with Jehovah God. In other words, Jesus Christ was the great propitiation, or let me put it in another sense, he was the perfect sacrifice for our sin. See, God had to do something about the sin problem, and the only way to do it was to have the perfect sacrifice. And who was more perfect, or who could be more perfect than he himself? And so Jesus Christ, who is God and was God and still is God, he came down from heaven, born of a virgin, walked the streets, preached for 3 years, and then died on a cross for our sins. If you go back and you investigate, you'll find out the reason for his crucifixion was not for anything that he had done, but it was because he was our substitute. He took our place. And because of that, even the thief on the cross, I don't know which one, whether one on the left or one right, but even the thief on the cross said, this man has done nothing wrong. He is innocent. And even that thief on the cross, what he saw in Jesus, he asked Jesus, and he said, remember me when I come into your kingdom today. And Jesus gave him a promise. Today, you will be with me in paradise. Why? Because I feel as though, even though it's not really said there, he repented of his sin. And he knew that what he did was wrong. And he was putting his faith in Jesus Christ as the perfect lamb that was there. See, man did not even ask God to send someone to die in their stead. God did this. Nor did man deserve such a gift. Well, maybe some of you think, well, I deserve it. Well, I'll be honest with you, I don't deserve anything. Whatever we get from God is grace. And whatever he gives us is grace. I don't deserve it. We didn't even deserve what he did. I didn't either. We did not. And out of agape love, God was doing a wonderful, wonderful thing. What was he doing by sending his son to die on the cross? What was he doing? Let me show you what he was doing. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and in verse 19, this is what God was doing. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, watch this, and not counting men's sins against them, as he was committed to us the message of reconciliation. Now, isn't that awesome? Just as the supreme proof of Abraham's love for God, what did Abraham do? You remember what Abraham did? He sacrificed his own son. God said, today, sacrifice your son. So he went on top of the mountain. And there, Isaac, he carried the wood. And they went up together. Before he was to kill him, God stopped him. But just as Abraham's love for God and was willingness to sacrifice his son, so also God was showing a foreshadow of what he was going to do in the future. And even on a grander scale now, Jehovah God the Father gave his only son, Jesus, as the supreme manifestation of his saving love for sinners. For the world, for everyone. To do what? To reconcile sinner to himself. What does it mean to reconcile? To restore that relationship that was severed because of the sin in our life. So Jesus Christ, by his blood, when we put faith in him as the Savior, that blood covers all of our sin. And we are reconciled to God. See, it's a relationship that God is looking for from people to people. You know, true, we come here on Sundays or Wednesdays or whatever, and we come together to worship, praise, and glorify God. But he wants a relationship with each and every one. You see? And so we have this ongoing relationship where each day we walk with him. Each day we talk with him. And this was God was doing through his son, reconciling us to himself. He did it. See, God didn't come to destroy. Jesus didn't come to destroy. And he told the people, I came to give life. See, so many people have this misconception concerning Jehovah God. He came and he sent his son into the world, as he says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And notice the benefit. Notice how we benefit. And notice what benefits the world's going to have now concerning eternal life that takes place. This is the third thing we see out of this one passage here. As it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, watch this, that whoever, doesn't matter who you are, whoever believes in Jesus, in him, shall not perish but have eternal life. Everybody's looking for eternal life. Nobody wants to die. Everybody. And that's true. We're all looking for eternal life. But that is found only in Jesus Christ. Amen. And only in him. The whole world, every man, woman, boy, girl, God graciously, his gracious gift of salvation, of eternal life, it's free. You don't have to work for it. You don't have to buy it. You don't have to do somersaults or flips or anything else like that. It's available, but there's only one small condition. Only one thing you have to do is believe in Jesus Christ. Salvation, eternal life, is found only in Jesus Christ, and it is for anyone who comes to Jesus Christ, who repents of his sins and coming. You see, that's why Jesus went to the cross. And believe in the one, as it says, for whoever believes in him. Believe in what? Believe that he died on the cross for your sins. That by his blood, you've been cleansed and you've been made whole again. It's that simple concerning it. See, it's not of works, not of money, not even church membership, not even doing good deeds. We come here together to do what? To worship, praise, and glorify God. Such an awesome God that we have. The great gospel duty, again, is to believe in Jesus Christ. Again, to believe that he died on the cross for your sins, and that by his blood you're cleansed and made whole. The great gospel benefit is that by believing in Jesus Christ, you have eternal life. You say, wow, is it that simple? Yeah, it's that simple. It is that simple. People make it hard. They feel like, you know what? It can't be that simple. I've got to do something. What kind of work must I do? Well, I'm going to tell you, you do have to do some work. And Jesus made it known. What kind of work is required?
To spread the gospel.
No. No, there's only one work that's required. According to John chapter 6 and verse 29, or I go up to 28, it says, they ask him, what must we do the works God requires? And it says, and Jesus answered, the work of God is this, to believe in the one that he has sent. That's it. To believe in Jesus Christ. And it's that simple. We make it hard. We think, oh, I must do many other things in order for me to have eternal life. No. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Believe in what he's done at Calvary. See, God was the initiator in our salvation. He was the author. He was the principal worker in it by many means. Not only did he send his son, he sent his Holy Spirit and His Holy Spirit works in us. And by the power of His Holy Spirit, we come to know Him. He enlightens us. He reveals the things of God to us concerning all those things. And so God's love is revealed in Jesus Christ at the cross so much and in it all. And it shows. But you understand that the love of God, it is broad enough to encompass even the worst sinner. I don't care how much you have done wrong. I don't care how bad of a sinner you think you are. And the blood of Christ covers all those sins. Now, it doesn't mean that you won't suffer for the consequences of your sin, just as so many others did. But what it does mean is that if you come to know Jesus Christ, and you believe in Him, and you repent of your sin, and you put faith in Jesus, you'll have eternal life. But He did say, for those who do not believe in Jesus, you will not have eternal life. You see, you've got many religions today, many isms, I like to call them. And their premise is this. Now, you could look at it if you want. Their premise is that in order to have eternal life, you've got to do a certain amount of works in order to have eternal life. Not so. And that's just, I don't know why it is that they hate Christianity so much. But they do. All these isms are against Christianity. All of them. Especially some of them. According to some of them, we are infidels. And their main purpose is to kill all the infidels. And if they kill us, they get a way to go to heaven. You can look it up yourself if you want later on. But here's the glorious thing. Even they, these many isms, if they too turn away from that and turn to God and put faith in Jesus Christ, they too will be saved. They too will have all of that cleansed and made whole again concerning it. So you see, we're all sinners. And we're saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. And the Word of God is clear. In Romans chapter 10 and verse 9 and following, it says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. Such an awesome God that we have. And what Jesus prayed also with His disciples, this was His prayer before He was put on the cross or while He was in the Garden of Gethsemane. Father, and it's coming from John chapter 17, as He so prayed this, and He said, Father, a time has come to glorify Your Son, and that Your Son may glorify You. For You granted Him authority over all people, that He might, what? Give eternal life to all of those You have given Him. Now, this is eternal life, that they may know You, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom You sent. I brought You glory on earth by completing the work You gave Me. And now, Father, glorify Me in Your presence with the glory that I have with You before the world began. Now, what was the work that Jesus completed? His death on the cross. See, that was the work He came to do. He completed it. He's saying in advance, I'm completing the work. In other words, He knew He was going to the cross. And by His sacrifice, it was meant for us. And now we're cleansed and we're made whole to any and all. And again, Jesus is informing Nicodemus, any who come, He says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Jesus has eternal life. It's very simple. Believe on Him, thou shalt be saved. So the question is do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? If you do, you have eternal life. And one day you'll be with God forever and ever. But if not, you are not. It's up to you. What do you want to do? Man's responsibility, woman's responsibility, a boy's responsibility, a girl's responsibility is to put faith in Jesus Christ. And with that, you can have eternal life. If God has spoken to you, and if you do not know him, you can come today and know him as Lord and Savior. Let us stand. Almighty God, as we come now, Lord, and if there's any whom you have spoken to, whose heart that you have opened, and they do not have a relationship with you, they do not truly know Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior, I pray, Lord, they will come now. And I pray you have opened that up in their hearts, in their ears, and in their eyes. In the name of Jesus, amen. If God has spoken to you, you come as we sing our invitation hymn, as well as our parting hymn, hymn number 277. Take my life, Lord, and concentrate it unto thee. To us, and as we look around and you see hearts and you see different things through the coming weeks already with the Valentines and everything else, just remember, God gave us the greatest Valentine gift of all, his only Son, for God so loved, and that love is agape. He loved us unconditionally, and because of it, he gave that which is very close. And he gave what was important and what was needed, and that is Jesus Christ. I pray that you will come to understand and know the depth of God and his love and what he did. Indeed, the greatest thing of all. We're praying for you if you do not know Jesus as your Lord and your Savior. We invite you to come back next Sunday, 10:30, as we have our morning worship service. And I ask that you, in the meantime, read your Bibles. Read your Bibles during the course of the week. Even if it's just one chapter a day, even if it's just a few verses a day, read it and allow God to speak to you, that you may walk with him and have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Not just on Sunday, but every day, Monday through Saturday. Read, talk, and speak. God does listen, and he does hear. I pray God's blessing upon each and every one. Al, lead us in a closing prayer.
Heavenly Father, again, we come before you, thanking you for all that you've done for us. And above all, thanking you for the love that you have for us. And Father, we pray That love you have for us dwells within us, and that, Father, we will share that love to others, and that, Father, we will care and concern with others. Father, we'll pray, we'll witness, we'll do what you call upon us to do. Be with us, Father, now as we leave and go our separate ways. Bring us back to worship again together. In thy Son's precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.